Random House Audio presents Mountains Beyond Mountains, The Quest of Dr. Paul Farmer, A Man Who Would Cure the World, by Tracy Kidder, winner of the Pulitzer Prize. Adapted for young people by Michael French. Read for you by Lincoln Hoppe. Introduction. Mountains Beyond Mountains is a book about a remarkable man, Dr. Paul Farmer. I met him in Haiti, that desperately poor country just a two-hour plane ride from the American mainland. He was spending a large part of his time there, among some of the poorest of the poor, treating their illness and, more important, creating a public health and medical system for them. He seemed to be performing all this difficult work for no personal reward except the satisfaction of doing it. Dr. Farmer could have worked in any number of hospitals in the United States, conducting important research, curing patients, and living a comfortable and respected life. What made him do otherwise? I wrote this book because I was curious about him, and I thought his life would make for a good story. I didn't write my book to make people believe in his cause. But well before the end of my research, I did believe. I'd been writing books and magazine articles for a number of years when I met Dr. Farmer. I was not the sort of journalist you see on television or in the movies. I didn't cover the news. I didn't put microphones in people's faces or go to press conferences. Instead, I wrote about life as it is lived out of the spotlight, by people who are not celebrities. I wrote a book about a team of engineers designing a computer, one about a school teacher, another about the building of a house, and even one about some very old people in a nursing home. I wrote about ordinary people, but once I got to know them, I found that none were really ordinary. My most important technique for research was simply hanging out with my subjects. I would try to fit into their lives, to be as unobtrusive as possible, and I would try to understand them by watching what they did. I hung out with Farmer, too. Although he was not famous when I met him, he was nobody's idea of an ordinary person. He was already an important figure in medicine, public health, and medical anthropology, and he worked impossible hours in impossible circumstances. In one of the poorest parts of Haiti, he had built a modern facility that provided health care for people who were living and dying in abject poverty. He seemed never to sleep. He seemed to be loved and admired not just by his patients, but by practically everyone who knew him. I spent long stretches with him in Haiti and traveled with him internationally. Traveling with Farmer is not like being a tourist. I accompanied him to Russia, a country I had never visited before. On my own, I would have enjoyed touring the Kremlin and certainly would have gone out of my way to see a performance of the Bolshoi Ballet in Moscow. Instead, we went to Moscow's central prison, full of inmates ill and dying from tuberculosis, and then to an even more desperate outpost in Siberia. It was the same in Peru. Most Americans visiting there want to make the ascent to the ancient ruins of Machu Picchu. I would have liked that too. But to travel with Farmer was to go directly into the tuberculosis-infected slums of Lima. None of this was much fun, to be honest. But it was spellbinding. And it was exhilarating to see how much Farmer and his small group of colleagues were able to accomplish, both in helping individual patients and in changing international health policies. When you write about people in depth, you are always interested in how they grew up, what they were like as children. And usually you go looking for the evidence. For part of his boyhood, Paul lived with his family in an old school bus, which they called the Bluebird Inn. After about 5 years of that, Farmer's father, a great big man who was nicknamed Elbows by people who played basketball with him, moved the whole family onto a half homemade 50-foot-long boat that was moored in a bayou in South Florida. The family had little money, but most of them relished their unorthodox lifestyle, at least when they looked back on it. It seemed as if, for a lot of the time, they had a lot of fun, At one point, Paul's father decided to earn his living as a fisherman, but he knew nothing about the ocean or fishing. The experiment didn't last long. Soon, the boat rarely left its place in the bayou. Paul was a brainy boy, and he did well in school, even though he didn't have a bedroom or a quiet place to do his homework. He went to Duke University on a full scholarship, and there discovered first wealth and then migrant farm workers toiling in the fields of North Carolina. Many were Haitian. He became interested in their lives because they seemed so different from the comfortable life he was leading at Duke, and so hidden from that lovely campus. He studied all things Haitian, the country's religion, its art and music, its language, and its amazing history. Haiti is a country created by former slaves, kidnapped West Africans who threw off their extremely cruel French masters. At times, they had to fight the English, too, and created their own republic. It's the only place in the world where this happened, but it happened in 1804, when slavery still flourished here in the United States. And to make a very long and painful story short, Haitians have been punished ever since for claiming their freedom. So Farmer imagined Haiti first, and then, after graduating from Duke, he made his first trip there. From that point on, he had a mission in life. By the time he got to medical school at Harvard, he was already working with friends to create the medical complex Zanmi La Santé, which is described in this book. Farmer's early life couldn't explain the man he became, but it was clear that he had learned something about poverty and how the world, when confronted with the poor, tends to look the other way. Farmer is so gifted, so self-sacrificing, and so passionate about his cause that it is sometimes hard to believe he's for real. That was part of my problem as a writer, how to make him believable to people reading my book. That's why I chose to write about myself in this book, so that readers can see what it's like to meet someone who operates on a much different level from the rest of us. At first, Paul Farmer made me feel inadequate and even a little guilty. He was doing all these wonderful things to end suffering in the world. What was I doing? But he didn't mean to make me feel that way, and I came to realize that he did not expect everyone to follow his path. I hope that this young adult adaptation of Mountains Beyond Mountains will help a new generation to get a sense of the extent of global poverty and the challenges and opportunities it presents to those who want to help improve the world. Farmer's life looked very difficult to me at first, and it still looks exhausting and endlessly demanding. But it is also a life that is rich in rewards. I remember talking about all this to my editor, who said something about Farmer that I think is true. His life looks hard, but it also looks enviable. When he wakes up in the morning, he doesn't have all sorts of conflicting feelings about his life. He knows what he's going to do, and he believes it's what he ought to do, what he was put on earth to do. If there is a lesson to this book, that may be it. Not that everyone should go out and try to cure the world, but that all our lives are richer for having purpose, for pursuing something larger than ourselves. Tracy Kidder. Part 1. Doktè Paul. Chapter 1. I first met Paul Edward Farmer 2 weeks before Christmas 1994. I was in Haiti as a journalist, writing about the presence of 20,000 American soldiers there. The soldiers' job was to reinstate the country's democratically elected government, in the process stripping power from the junta, a government composed of military leaders whose corrupt and cruel reign had gone on for 3 years. The evening I met Farmer, I was sitting on a second-story balcony of a military outpost, talking with U.S. Army Special Forces Captain John Carroll. The compound was a desperate-looking place. Concrete walls enclosed a weed-dotted parade field, a jail, and a mustard-colored barracks. The captain was stationed with 8 American soldiers in Haiti's rural central plateau, charged with keeping the peace for 150,000 Haitians, mostly peasants, spread over 1,000 square miles. The task seemed daunting, if not impossible. The grisly murder of a popular local official, the assistant mayor, had been beheaded, and his body tossed in the Artibonite River, was making life even more complicated for Captain Carroll. The suspect most locals considered the killer was a member of the junta. He had been captured and briefly detained by the captain, only to be released by him for lack of physical evidence and reliable witnesses. Carroll was shaking his head in frustration about the crime and about all the challenges of peacekeeping when an aide appeared and told him an American was waiting at the compound gate to see him. There were, in fact, 5 visitors, 4 of them Haitian, but my gaze lingered on a tall, lanky white man in his mid-30s as the group joined us on the balcony. The American introduced himself as Paul Farmer, a doctor who worked in a hospital in a nearby town called Mirabalais, helping poor people. Farmer had short black hair and a high waist and thin, long arms. His nose came almost to a point, upon which rested a pair of rimless glasses. Despite his pale and even delicate appearance, especially compared to the tanned and muscular Special Forces captain, there was something undeniably confident, even cocky, about him. Farmer asked the captain if anyone in the compound needed medical attention. Carroll advised him that he had some sick prisoners the local hospital refused to treat, so he had ended up buying the medicine himself. Farmer flashed a smile. "You'll spend less time in purgatory," he replied. Then he asked, "Who cut off the head of the assistant mayor?" The conversation between the captain and the doctor went in circles. Carroll insisted he couldn't be sure, but Farmer said that everyone in the region had a very clear idea who the killer was. I sensed that the doctor knew Haiti far better than the captain, and that he was trying to give him some important information. He suggested the murder suspect be arrested again, and this time held indefinitely. This was the practical thing to do, he hinted, to imprison the man rather than risk the anger of Haitians who were starting to lose confidence in Captain Carroll's leadership. Farmer seemed to care less about the notion that someone should be considered innocent until proven guilty than about preserving a thin-edged calm in a jittery country. I found the two men's views ironic. The captain, who described himself as a redneck, was arguing for due process. Farmer, who championed human rights and clearly was on the side of the poor, was arguing against it. The captain couldn't hide his overall pessimism. No matter what he did or didn't do about the murder suspect, he said, nothing was going to change Haiti in the long term. The United States Army had ventured here before, in the early 20th century, to restore order during another period of turmoil, only to leave and watch from a distance as the new government eventually collapsed. The same thing was going to happen when the army left this time, he predicted. Haiti would always be a desperately poor, corrupt, broken society. No one could fix it. Farmer agreed with some of the captain's points. Poverty and corruption were everywhere in Haiti, and the doctor had always been vocal about it. He thought the American government's plan to stabilize the local economy might help the wealthy business class, but it would do nothing to ease the suffering of the vast majority of people. Haiti occupies the western third of the island of Hispaniola in the Caribbean, while the more prosperous Dominican Republic, once ruled by Spain, governs the eastern two-thirds. Each country has a population of about 10 million, which means that life is far more crowded in Haiti. In fact, Haiti is the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. Workers in rural areas, which are home to two-thirds of the population, earn less than a dollar a day on average. Healthcare.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.